Hello everyone. Thank you for joining. Today, Lawyers Gyan is organizing a webinar on anti-defection law, its intent and constraint. Lawyers Gyan is a platform to share all the latest legal updates and opportunities and organizing events for them to share and gain knowledge from our experts. And by expert, we mean our speaker, Mr. Vishesh Bharadwaj, who is an assistant professor at IIMT Law College. He is going to tell us about the 10th schedule of our constitution, also known as the anti-defection law. So, Vishesh, over to you.
Thank you, Pringle. Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for coming to this seminar. And I would like to start with our topic, anti-defection law, its intent constraints. So starting with the introduction, what is defection? Defection has been defined as to abandon a position or an association, often to join the opposing party. Okay. And advanced law Lexicon dictionary defines it as crossing the floor by a member of parliament, as in you walk towards the other side of the floor, the other side of the chamber, you walk to the other party. This is the defection, where you do not owe any allegiance to your own party and commit or pledge your allegiance to another party. You vote in their favor. That is defection. Usually members do so because of the lavishing offers that are given to them so that they may join the ministerial post or any other post, or it might be the monetary considerations also. Usually it's the monetary considerations. This can be better understood with the help of case laws. So in the case of P.V. Narasimha Rao versus state through CBI, the major question before the Supreme Court was whether the Article 105 of the Indian Constitution prevent these member of parliaments from being prosecuted or from being from the corruption charges or the bribes that they take. So let me tell you first the facts of the case. The facts of the case were that in the general election of the Lok Sabha, the 10th Lok Sabha, which were held in 1991, the Congress party emerged as the single largest party. Okay. At that time, there were around 528 seats in the Lok Sabha, and P.V. Narasimha Rao became the prime minister at that time when the Congress government won the election. So in 1993, later on, 2 years after, a no confidence motion was introduced by Sri Ajay Mukhopadhyay. However, this no confidence motion moved in the favor of the Congress government. Around 251 members voted against them, the Congress government, and they said that they do not enjoy the confidence of the people. However, 265 members voted in favor of the Congress government, so they won the no confidence motion. But in 1996, a turnover came when Sri Ravindra Kumar of Rashtriya Mukti Morcha filed a complaint in CBI that there were the members of the party were bribed to vote in the favor of the other party. However, at that time, the anti-defection law was there, but the complaint was filed with the CBI, and CBI investigated, and a whooping amount of approximate 3 crores were also offered to the party members to vote in their favor, to vote in the favor of the Congress government. So this is a classical case of defection, where people vote in favor of the other people to obtain some benefits. There was another case of Raja Rampal versus Honorable Speaker Sabha and others. In this case, the member of parliament indulged in unethical and corrupt practices of taking monetary considerations. The fact was that around 12 members of parliament were found guilty in this case. A private channel broadcasted on 12th of December 2005. They broadcasted these member of parliaments taken bribe. 10 member of parliaments were from the Lok Sabha and one member of parliament was from the Raj Sabha. The TV channel broadcasted that these members were taking bribe. And later on, an inquiry was conducted and they all were found guilty of under the anti-defection law. Now, why is this anti-defection law necessary? It is necessary because India is a very large country. Being a very large country, it has various cultures and it has diverse needs. Every individual have their own needs. It cannot be expected from every individual to sit in the parliament to make decisions to govern the country. Therefore, we elect representatives who are going to represent our views in the parliament to make laws for us. Now with this, they come to our houses and they promise us that they will issue our needs if we vote in their favor, if we help them become the member of parliament or the state or the member of the state legislatures. But what happens is that there is another thing also, the party manifesto, the political parties. The political parties also have a manifesto and they also make some promises that in case you help win those parties by voting in favor of their candidates, they will address certain issues also. For example, let us take a case. Suppose I am in favor of uniform civil code and there is the member of parliament who is electing or who is contesting the election from my constituency. He comes to me and I say that I want the UCC to be passed in the parliament. He agrees with me that yes, and I will definitely issue and I will definitely take care of this issue and I will raise it in the parliament if you vote in favor of me. And but suppose he's from some party who do not support the Uniform Civil Code. Their manifesto states that religious rights should be upheld. They should be given the priority instead of Uniform Civil Code. Now, I'm not saying that the party is wrong and I'm right, or I'm right and the party is wrong. So, or the vice versa. But the thing is that both are right in their own views. And only one thing can be done. If under the anti-defection law, if a party whip is given that you are supposed to vote in, vote this when this question came up, then he has to do it. The anti-defection laws make mandatory for the member to vote exactly how they tell them. Okay. Now why? Because there is a party image that needs to be maintained. Okay. Usually you vote in the favor of any particular candidate based on their party. If you see many people, you ask them after any general election, what have you voted or whom did you vote? They are going to say, I voted Cycle, I voted Kamal, I voted this and that. So based on the party they voted, not based on the candidate. This happens in majority of the cases. Therefore, party plays a very important role in the governance of the country. Therefore, the members of any party won the election or won their seats based on the membership they have of that particular party. Therefore, they are bound by the decisions of that party itself. So if there is a conflict between the views of the party and what you want, for what you elected the contestant, then in that case, your views are going to fail. And it is not your view that will be upheld. Whatever the party dictate says, that will be the member you elected is going to vote in that favor. Now let us come to the historical background. In 1967, a famous phrase came up, Aaya Ram Gaya Ram. Now how did this came up? In 1967, a member of Legislative Assembly of Haryana, Gaya Ram, he, to surprise everyone, he changed the party three times in a single day. In a single day, he changed the party three times. But this was a shock for everyone, that how did this happen and why is he changing the party so much, this many times? So a phrase was made that Ayaram, Gayaram. From wherever he's receiving the benefits, he's going to move to that side. So this phrase is now used to refer to those legislators who do not owe any party loyalty. They are in it, in the politics, purely for themselves. The benefits that they will get, they are in it purely for themselves. Now, the seeds of anti-defection law were sown first in 1969 itself, the general elections conducted in the 1969. The Congress Party, though it emerged in majority and won the election, but it lost many seats when compared to the previous year or the previous tenure. Previously, it had 361 seats. Now they had 283 seats. So there was a major decline in the number of seats. So, and also during this 1967, they lost their majority in seven states. And why? Because the member of legislators of those seven states defected from the Congress government and joined some other government for merely for the purpose of getting any good post, the ministerial post, so that they may not only be the legislators, but also become the administrators, okay, to gain the executive powers. Now, and money was also a consideration. Now with this, a Congress member of parliament of the Lok Sabha, Mr. P. Venkat Subbaiah, who served in the cabinet of Rajiv Gandhi also and Indira Gandhi also, he proposed that a high-level committee should be set up. Now, although he had proposed this, but the opposition were not in the favor of this. They said that the Congress government is proposing this merely to save the Congress itself. So this proposal should be named as Save Congress. But however, the committee was made, and the committee was chaired by the then Home Minister, Shri Y.B. Chavan. Then Home Minister Y.B. Chavan. Okay. So this committee, though, defined the defection, that what will comprise the defection and what can be the exception that can be given to the genuine defectors. There might be some persons who might be considered as genuine defectors and what conditions these should be exempted. So the report of this committee noted that I mentioned the seven states, right? So the members of the seven states, around 210 defecting members, 116 were given the ministerial positions in the government they helped form. The government in whose favor they voted, they were given the ministerial positions in those governments. So it was clearly that they had done this to gain these positions. So to combat this, the committee recommended that there should be a bar on the members who defect. A minimum of 1 year sentence should be given that they cannot conduct the election. They cannot hold any position, a ministerial position, and they should be removed or they should be barred from contesting the election for at least that tenure, and they should not be permitted to enter the premises if they don't get re-elected in the next general election. Now, several attempts were made, particularly three attempts were made overall. The two attempts failed. One was made in 1973 by the then Home Minister Umashankar Dixit, and the next was made in 1978 by the then Law Minister Shanti Bhushan. But they both failed. But later on in 1985, the then Law Minister under the Prime Ministership of Rajiv Gandhi, the then Law Minister Ashok Kumar Sen, managed to dictate the whole law, the whole anti-defection law, in 2 days to the whole parliament. Okay, he navigated the bill throughout the parliament, and within 2 days, he managed to secure the majority in the Lok Sabha. It was done on the 30th January, on the death anniversary of the father of the nation, Mahatma Gandhi. On the very following day, Raj Sabha also approved the bill. So now let us come to what are the grounds on which member can be disqualified. There are particularly three grounds. First ground is if any member of a house belongs to any political party, and after winning the election, there are two conditions then. First, he either voluntarily gives up the membership of his or her political party and joins any other, or he just give up the political party. Okay, and the next is he votes contrary, or he does not vote in the chair at all, even after the direction given by the political whip, the political party whip. Then in those cases, he can be held guilty of defection. The next is, if any independent member joins a political party after the election, then in that case also, that member can be held guilty under the anti-defection law. Third, if any nominated member joins a political party after 6 months to become a member of legislature, or in this case, the legislature denotes both the level of government, the central and the state, both. Okay, so in these cases, the person may be held guilty of defection. What are the exemptions that were provided under the 10th schedule? First of all, if there is a merger. Merger with two-third majority can be done. Earlier it was, with the 15th Amendment, it was only one-third majority. But later on in 2003, an amendment was made, the 91st Constitutional Amendment, and two-third majority was made so that to provide a stringent law so that many members may not change their seats or go in the favor of the other person. Two-third majority. If it is less than that, then you will come under the anti-defection law, you will attract it, and you might face the consequences. Next is, if he votes in favor or against the merger, it does not attract the anti-defection law. You are free. You will not be penalized, or no action will be taken against you. Okay, so voting either in favor or against the merger does not concern the anti-defection law. Next is, if any member votes against the party dictate, or he abstains from such voting, then in that case, prior permission from the party member or the party dictate, the party whip. And if he fails to do so, then there is another option that he can obtain, or he can be condoned within 15 days from such voting abstention. The last one is, if the presiding officer, that means the speaker, deputy speaker, chairman or deputy chairman, and at the both level of the government, not just a single one, the both level of the government, that means the state government, the member, the state government and the central government. So presiding member includes both of them. So if he or she voluntarily gives up his membership before being elected to such an office, or rejoins it after he ceases to hold that position, that office, then there is an exception provided to him and he will not attract the anti-defection law. Now, what are the other issues that need to be addressed in this regard? First of all, accountability of elected representatives. Let me tell you, the accountability of elected representatives is diluted by the anti-defection law. How? I told you previously that you want your elected representative to vote in the favor of something, and the party wants him to vote in against that thing, then he is bound to vote with the party. Whatever the party says, he is going to follow it. And when you will ask him that why you did such an act, or why you disobeyed what we wanted, then in that case, he can say that there was a party whip and I could have done nothing in regard to this. I was bound to do what the party told me. So, and if I disobeyed, then I might be removed and I will not be able to serve you further. Therefore, I did such an act. And what can you say then? He is free. The next is voluntary giving up the membership. Now, voluntary giving up the membership is a very vague, and it has been left wide open. What will include voluntary giving up the membership? This was also addressed by the court in the case of Jagjit Singh, Ravi S. Nayak, but the court also failed to give the boundaries to this term. Okay, like in the case of Jagjit Singh versus State of Haryana, the court stated that, just a second, the court stated that voluntary giving up of the membership does not include resignation. even in the absence of a formal resignation from the member, it can be inferred from the act of the member that he or she is no more acting in favor of the particular party and has defected or has given up his membership from that party. The same thing was said in the case of Ravi S. Nayak versus Union of India. The court, however, added that the terms, the voluntary giving up the membership and the resignation, are not synonymous to each other. And the prior term, that is the voluntary giving up of the membership, is wider in its ambit and needs to be controlled. But the court also failed to give a boundary to this term. So the legislature needs to address this. The next case was the Rajendra Singh Rana versus Swami Prasad Maurya. In this case, it was told that what would also include the voluntary membership, what act would be included. Like in the previously, I said that it can be inferred from the conduct of the member that he has voluntarily given up his membership. What does this include? So in this case, a written document sent to the governor, which contained the sign of the member of any political party, and the letter speaks against that political party, then it will be considered as defection. Okay, so this also acts as a voluntary giving up of the membership. Now let us come to the next point, merger and split. Many a times people confuse themselves between merger and split. Merger is when a political party merges with another political party. That means an amalgamation between two or more political parties. And split is when a political party divides itself into many parts. That is a split. Okay. A split is not a concern of the anti-defection. Merger is. Two-third majority is needed in order to merge. Otherwise, you come under the anti-defection law. So it's very clear. This can be better understood by the case Mayawi versus Markande Chand and others. In this case, general elections were held in the state of Uttar Pradesh in 1997. And Bharatiya Janata Party came up in the majority. But they turned out to be the single largest party. But they did not have the absolute majority in the parliament. Therefore, the governor invited BSP also to merge with BJP and form a coalition government. So both the parties came to an agreement that after 6 months, they will change their chief minister, or the seats will be exchanged between the Mayawati, the BSP leader, and Kalyan Singh, the BJP leader. So first of all, the tenure was given to Mayawati. So when she ruled 6 months and it came the time period for Kalyan Singh to take over from her, she refused. She said, no, I'm not giving up. So Kalyan Singh was shocked. The BJP felt betrayed. Therefore, they went to the governor that she's not giving up. We agreed. But since constitution contains no such, or any law contains no such provisions with regard to the agreement which are made to take the chief minister position turn by turn, so the governor said, you will have to prove your majority, take the floor test. If you turn out to be in majority, then the chief ministership is yours. So prove your majority. The Kalyan Singh government in that floor test turned out to be successful. The BJP government won the floor test, the no confidence motion. And the Mayawati government failed. But how did this happen? 12 members of the BSP were brought by the BJP. The Kalyan Singh government was later on found guilty. Okay, so when the Mayawati saw that they have failed in this floor test, given to the speaker that these 12 members should be disqualified on the anti-defection law and their vote should not be even be counted. The speaker said that no, it was a split. So I'll address this also, the decision of the speaker. Okay, we'll address this in the conclusion. So the speaker said, no, it was a split. Therefore, we cannot say that it comes under the anti-defection law, and hence the voting is going to proceed. Now she went to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court overruled the decision of the speaker and said that it is a clear case of defection and they are guilty under the anti-defection law, and those 12 members were disqualified on the grounds of defection by the Supreme Court. Now let us come to the last point: freedom of speech, dissent and conscience. What does it mean? How did this came into figure? When any political party mandates any member to vote in a particular manner, then in that case they restrict the freedom of speech and conscience of that particular member. This case, this can also be better understood in the case of Kihoto Holohan versus Zia Chulu. In this case, although the major point was that the constitutionality of the 10th schedule was itself challenged, but let us focus on the freedom of speech, dissent and conscience. Many grounds were raised in this case that this schedule should not sustain and it should be declared unconstitutional. But in this regard, the Supreme Court said that there needs to be some control of the party over its members. They need to govern these members. And in that case, it might be considered as a reasonable restriction. The freedom of speech, dissent and conscience can be constrained. And this is a reasonable restriction because there is a greater benefit to it. The problem of bribery, the corruption, all of these also needs to be kept a check on. Therefore, it is okay. But however, the main issue in the case was regarding the constitutional validity of the 10th schedule itself. Okay, so in that regard also the Supreme Court ruled that para 7 only should be overruled and it should be removed. It applied the doctrine of severability and removed the para 7, which curtailed the judicial review power of the judiciary. Now coming to the conclusion, the anti-defection law has enabled political parties to have a stronger grip on their members, and which have many times prevented their members to vote or to come in the lure of the money or political positions, the ministerial berths, etc. And it has also provided a stability in the government. Otherwise, there will be a continuous change in the government itself. So anti-defection law is very good in that regard, but there are also some lacunas. There are also some points to be addressed. First of all, the voluntary giving of the membership term is too vague. Even Supreme Court was not able to decide or constrain a boundary for it. Therefore, it needs to be addressed by the legislature itself, and particular instances should be mentioned in which it will be considered as voluntary giving of the membership. Next is instances where a party whip can be issued. These should be, according to my views, this should be constrained to only the views which can topple the government itself. It should be restricted to those points only. Party should be allowed to vote or to give a party whip in those instances only. The last one is power of the speaker chairman should be reviewed. As we discussed the case of Mayawati versus Markande Chand, in that case, we saw that the speaker clearly was aware that the members are defectors, but instead of that, he voted in favor of them and said that no, it is a split. So clearly the speaker was aware, and in many other cases, this has happened, that speaker becomes biased. Therefore, the office of the speaker or the chairman cannot be termed as an office which can remain unbiased. So an independent office should be introduced. The election commission itself has said that the president or the governor should be the person who should decide on whether the person is a defector or not, but based on the binding advisory of the election commission itself. So one might say that there are something that needs to be reviewed in this regard also, but I don't think the election commission should be given the power. An independent, other independent office should be absolutely created in this regard. and it should be given the power. So with this, I'd like to end my speech and thank you very much. I'd like to thank LoisCan team for inviting me. Over to you, LoisCan team.
Hello. Thank you, Vishesh, for such a great webinar. Anyone has any questions you can ask? I think no one is asking a question. So thank you, everyone.
If you come up any question later on, then you can also email me. Okay, you can email me at my email ID, visheshbharadwaj9@yahoo.in.
Okay, thank you everyone for attending the webinar. Hope you understood it and noted down the important points. We are going to upload this on our YouTube channel also. You can watch it there also. Thank you everyone.